Okay, it's recording. Okay, can. So for today, right, actually I will talk about three papers. Of course, the most important one is the first one, Reflection of Trusting Trust. That's by Ken Thompson. The next two papers, I will just briefly touch and go about them because they actually build on the work done by Ken Thompson. Okay, so maybe some of you do not know who Ken Thompson is. So Ken Thompson is the guy on the left. So the guy on his right is Dennis Ritchie. So both of them, they won the 1983 Turing Award because they created the Unix operating system. So as a privilege of winning the award, right, they have the privilege of choosing a topic, any topic to present upon. So Thompson chose to present on Reflection on Trusting Trust.
So can you full screen the presentation?
No, because there's a problem with the recording. I cannot full screen
it. Alright.
Okay, so opening statement. So in the first sentence of his paper, he said, to what extent should one trust the statement that the program is free of Trojan horses? Perhaps it's more important to trust the people who wrote the software. Okay, so let's go deeper. Here's the problem. How do we know whether a program is safe? So maybe we can inspect the program source code. Then isn't the program source code compiled by a compiler? Then maybe we can now inspect the compiler source code. For example, if a GCC, you can inspect GCC source code. Now the next issue is, isn't the compiler compiled by another compiler? So in the case of self-hosting compilers, right, like GCC, GCC compiles itself. So this is now a rabbit hole issue. So how deep do we go from here? So now let's look at some real life compiler attacks. So these compiler attacks, what they do is that they inject malicious code into compiled apps. So there's actually two real life examples. The first one is Xcode Ghost. So this was discovered in September 2015. So what happened here is that a malicious hacker, right, he released actually a bad version of Xcode. So if you compile your iOS apps through it, right, you inject a malicious payload into your binary. So yeah, this is an issue that why this came about is because Xcode, Apple servers outside, very slow to access Apple servers outside of China, inside China. So what some hacker did is that actually they created this malicious version of Xcode, then it hosts inside China. Then Chinese developers start to use this malicious Xcode, so resulting in this problem. Then the other example is actually this Win32 in Dark A, discovered in 2009. So what this virus does actually, it modifies the Delphi compiler. Then whenever it compiles anything through this malicious compiler, it will produce a malicious binary. And this malicious binary will further infect other Delphi compilers. So as another bad thing about this virus, also it creates a botnet. Okay, so this proves that actually this is not just an academic exercise. There are actually real life attacks already. So the objective for today, we will try to modify a compiler to add a malicious code to a targeted compiled source, for example a login program. Then we'll try to add malicious code to the compiler binary to propagate this behavior. Whenever it sees a compiler source code, it will make sure that the compiler binary will also further infect future versions. And then finally, we must not leave a trace in the compiler source code also. So how do we actually do this? So in the Ken Thompson's paper, right, he actually gives three stages of proof. So the first three here. The fourth stage actually is my own custom edition because I feel that it's something that is worthwhile doing. Okay, then the conclusion. So let's come to the stage number one, which is the concept of a self-reproducing program. So this is called a queen. So a source is actually a source program that when compiled and executed will produce as output an exact copy of its source. So let's see what an example of this. Here. So I have one here. Okay? So now let's compile this thing and see what happens. So in here, I'll use GCC. Okay, so some of you may not be familiar with the command line argument for GCC. So what this means is that, I'll invoke GCC, send the source code in, they'll specify the file name of the source code and specify the file name of the output binary. Okay? So now let's run this. You can see, it prints out the source code of itself. Yeah. Okay. So now let's output this to a file. In case some of you are not sure whether this what I say is correct, let's do this. Okay. So I redirect the output to a file here. Then I open this. Yeah. You can see. Yeah, exactly the same. Now, of course, if you don't believe what I say, right, I can always do a diff. So just div between the queen and the new queen. See, no output. They are bit for bit identical to each other. So how does this thing work actually? So you can see here, right? Okay, let's close this. Very simple. Here, this actually is a version of its own source code here. So what it does is just print. But what's special about here is that I have to inject the new line characters in here. So number 10 is a ASCII code for a new line. The horizontal tab is 9 and the apostrophe is 34 here. Okay, then some of you may wonder, right, how do you actually write a queen? I mean, I'm digressing a bit, but yeah, this is what I found interesting. When I write this, how do you write one? So for example, right, if I do something like INTI, that immediately the queen property of this program is broken. So how do we solve this? So here, see, I injected this point here, right, the comment. Prints on source code. So I just type it here. Okay, then I add %c. This is to, so I can inject the new line character later. Then maybe I'll put it somewhere, okay, here. Then after that, copy this and paste it here. So we can have something like our new queen already. Okay, get the idea, right? Okay, this is not exact, something, okay. Okay, so stage number two, knowledge propagation. So now we'll try to have a compiler, right, that can pass down knowledge. So in this case, I call it the compiler training. We want to recognize a new data type. So first, let's start with my compiler. So of course, I call it compiler.c. Okay, sorry. So obviously I did not run my own compiler from scratch. So what I actually do is that I actually read in the source code and I send it to GCC via the standard input. So actually you can actually do that, you know. I mean, GCC most of the time if we use, right, you specify a file name to it. But here you can actually send it via the standard input. Okay? Any questions about this? This dummy compiler which I created. Okay. Next. So to test whether this compiler works, let me compile it first. So let me compile this. So compiler c.o clean compiler dot out. Okay. Then here I have a very simple hello world program. Very obvious, no explanation needed. So now to test my compiler, I compile this up. So notice that my compiler prints out the code that is sent to GCC. So this thing will be important later. Okay, prints hello world. So yeah, my compiler is working. So from now on, we can actually technically discard GCC.
Are you calling GCC?
Yeah, sorry. Any question?
You're still calling.
Yeah. Okay. Let's not care about the back end of my own compiler lah. So just think of it as this is my own compiler now. Yeah. Okay. So now the next thing I want to do is that I want to add something to the C standard. For example, I want to create this uin1 data type, which is actually short for universal unsigned integer 1 byte size. So this is actually same as char. Of course, this data type doesn't exist, but for the sake of example, let's create this data type. Okay. Okay. So this is my new hello world program, but instead of a char data type, I use a uin1 data type. So let's compile this and see what happens. So this is hw dash. Okay, of course the compiler will show you errors because this is an unknown data type. Okay, so now we will try to train our compiler to recognize this new uin1 data type. So I'll call this training compiler. Okay, so the difference between this training compiler and the compiler of before is that now whenever it sees the U in one, the word, it will convert it to char before setting to GCC. I mean, this is just a hack lah, but what I'm saying here is that this training compiler can now recognize this new keyword. Can I understand this point? Okay, so now we will take our existing compiler and we will compile this training compiler. Okay, can. So now this is our training compiler binary. Let's pass in our new Hello World program. Can compile. But behind the scenes, what it actually does is that it converts the UIN1 text to char. So now let's run this new Hello World program. It works. Okay, so what I've shown here is that now I've sort of added a new standard to C and my compiler can recognize this. Okay, so now with this new C standard, right, the compiler source code can actually adopt this UIN1 keyword. So let's open our new compiler, which is called train compiler. You can see, right, in this train compiler, right, there's no more char keyword at all already. Everything uses UIN1. Okay, so now let's compile this. So let's use our training compiler and compile our train compiler C code. It works. But actually behind the scenes, it converts everything to char before sending to GCC. Okay. So we use our train compiler to compile our new Hello World program. See, it works. Okay. Example clear?
What's the difference between the training compiler and
second?
I didn't really get the difference between the training compiler and the training.
Okay, for training compiler, right, it is the source code can still be compiled by GCC because it's all in standard C. But it's now able to recognize this new UIN1 keyword. Okay? So now, since that our compiler can recognize this new keyword, right, we can actually use this new keyword in the compiler's own source code. So this is called train compiler. So the concept I want to illustrate here is actually called compiler bootstrapping. So if you're not familiar with this, right, it's like, okay, when you start, for example, you want to create a new language, you want to start a new compiler, right, you create a compiler that only implements a small subset of the language. Then after that, right, you train the compiler to recognize new features of the language. Then once the compiler can recognize these new features, the compiler's own source code can use these new features because you can compile incrementally, build up. So this is just one example here. Yeah, here. Program can output, a compiler can propagate knowledge to the next generation. Okay, here, this point here, a program can output extra text not relevant to itself. I'm referring to the comments up here. Because you actually don't need comments in the compilation process. Okay, so now with the knowledge we have, right, let's conduct the attack. So here I have, if login.c is a program responsible for logins, we want to add an undetectable backdoor to this login.c. Okay, so now let me open login.c. Okay. Very simple here. So you can see here, this I've actually hard coded a list of username and password inside here. So what this login program does, right, is that you will pass your username and password via the command line arguments here. Then I'll just look through. If let's say the username and password matches what I have hard-coded, it will print authorized, if not print unauthorized. Clear for this? Okay, now let's see this for real, how it looks. So I'll use the clean compiler first to compile this. So, you can see a list of acceptable username and password combinations. Let's put something that doesn't exist. For example, you don't belong. Okay? But now I put a real one. Alex1000. Authorized. So, as long as the username and password is in this list, it will be authorized. Okay, so let's add a backdoor account. So maybe the most straightforward way is to add a backdoor in the source code. Okay. So here, login.hack. Okay. So now this program here, right, have this extra lines of code. If let's say the username is a hacker and the password is I hate numbers, then I'll print authorize, regardless of whatever is stated here. Okay, so now let me compile this. Okay, so this is our backdoor account. Authorized. So obviously this thing doesn't exist. This user account is not supposed to be there. Of course, anybody who looks at this source code, right, if you see these lines of code, right, you'll be like suspicious already, right? Okay, so the next thing is, why not we get our compiler to inject this source code in? Okay, so now let me show you the compiler. So this compiler is different from the clean compiler in the sense that it has many extra lines of code here, so I'll explain what they do. So here I notice that this and this, the same, right? Between these two. So it's actually going to, whenever it sees that you're compiling login.c, it will attempt to inject this code, which is exactly the same as this, into the login source code before the compilation process. Okay, so I'm not going to explain this bunch of code here because actually this. So what this long lines of code is doing is that here I'll find where to inject the code, which is just before printf text unauthorized. Okay, so you can see here, right? Printf text unauthorized. I want to inject this bunch of code before this point. So here, I'm looking for this. Scr, find this. After that, I'll create a new array, then copy this code here, copy this bytes here, copy these bytes here, and put my injector code here. So this is what all these lines are doing here. Okay, so let me get my clean compiler to compile this. So compiler hack login dot c. Okay. So we get our bad compiler to compile our clean login.c here. Notice login.c, not login hack. So let me just call this executable bad login.out. Okay. See, the compiler has injected this source code in. So even though we send in a clean login, right, clean login program, the compiler injects the bad code in. Then the next thing is, if anybody who inspects this compiler source code, right, you will notice this one. Yeah. So why not, right, if you have this extra thing called compiler hack itself. Whenever the compiler sees that it's trying to compile itself, right, you inject this code in to itself. Okay, so let me show you that. Let me show you the actual code for this. Okay, so this is compiler hack itself. So we still have this here. Now we have this extra thing, text inject compiler. So you see here, right? If let's say I detect that this compiler is trying to compile itself, it will inject this. It will inject the login code, the login attack code, and the compiler attack code here. If you have any question, just feel free to stop. Yeah. But y'all can understand the point, right? Okay. So now let me do the example here. So I'll get my clean compiler again to compile this. Okay, now we can now discard the compiler hack itself. That means, right, this is actually the best source code, we can just throw it away. Don't need to care already. So now we get the compiler hack itself to compile the clean login source code. Login.out. Okay? So you can see, right, he injects the malicious code into the login program. So to prove that this actually works, okay, so this is the backdoor account. So now I'll show you can use this compiler to compile even the clean source code and you still inject the code in. So now let's show. So this is the clean source code, compiler.c. So I'll call this evil child compiler. Should be works, okay. So you see, we know the compiler.c is very small, right? But you can see, it's injected so much thing inside. All this, here. Okay. So now we use our evil child compiler and compile the login program. Still evil login. Okay? You can see here that the malicious code is here. Okay, so let's try with our backdoor account. Still works. Okay, then just for something extra, right? We still can use this evil child compiler, right? To compile again. Compiler.c-o evil child compiler 2. You can see. Its children still pass on the attack code. Even though this source code does not exist anymore. And okay, let me just do ls-l, right? You see the binary size of evil child compiler? All the same, 13,604 bytes. All the same. Even though it's gone through multiple compilation processes already. Okay, so let me summarize what's going on here. So this is actually technically where the original paper has ended. So here, you can see, right? The C compiler backdoor source code pass through a C compiler, you get a C compiler backdoor binary. You pass a login source code to a normal C compiler, you get the normal binary. You pass a C compiler source code through a normal compiler, you get a normal binary also. But when you pass in through a backdoor binary, right, this bad compiler will inject in the malicious code. So this is what's going on for the past few stages. Okay, any questions? Okay. So now this is actually the how would one normally try to detect this is that you use a SHA-256 hash or MD5 or whatever lah. So what this does is that I will look through this and this program SHA-SUM will look through it, you generate the hash here. Okay. Okay. So SHA-SUM-A256. So a clean compiler has this hash 7C76, which I recorded here. And we look at what is the SHA-SUM generated for a bad compiler. It's a typo. Okay, BEAA. So immediately you can tell, right, the compiler binary is different. So a cursory verification will tell you this already. But so,
sorry? If your system has already been backdoor,
yeah.
How are you going to get a clean SHA-SUM in the first place?
Oh yeah, I'm coming to that.
Oh.
Yeah. So here, subverting verification. So can we prevent the user from detecting the bug compiler? We can actually subvert the SHA-256 program also. So this is actually subverting verification already. That means if somebody try to find out the tools that the person will use to check this, right? You can actually infect the tool also, which is what I'm going to demonstrate. So of course I don't have access to a SHA-SUM. SHA-SUM program is by Apple, I don't have the source code. So what I do is I'll roll my own version. Here. Stitch. So let's open my SHA. Okay, so obviously I didn't run my own SHA-256 source code, I just pulled from some open source site. But the idea here is here lah. So whenever you send a file name of the something that you want to measure to this, to command line argument, and then you will just measure the SHA-SUM value and print it out. Okay, so just do a quick demo. I'll use my clean compiler first, of course. Okay. 256.out. Okay, so just to be to be sure, right, I use my own SHA-256 implementation to verify what is the SHA-sum value of the clean compiler, so 7C76, which means my implementation is the same as Apple's one. So now let's use this to check stage 3's compiler head itself. So BE8A, so it's the same. Okay, so now let's try to hack my SHA-256 program. So what I will do, okay, let me show you the source code first. So largely the same, the only difference is that when the SHA-256 program sees that you're trying to measure the compiler source code, right, it will return what you expect it to be, which is 7C76, which is that of a clean compiler binary. Okay, so let me run the example. Okay. Okay. So this one you return 7C76. So now let's try to measure what is the SHA-sum of the other one. Okay, it still returns 7C76. So a user who use this malicious SHA-256 program will think that, it's okay, right? Yeah, no problem. Okay, so now to confirm again, let's use the Apple's own clean implementation. Okay, this is what is the actual value. But my bug SHA-256 program returns you the clean value, even though you're actually measuring the malicious compiler binary. Understand? Of course, again, anybody who sees this, right, yeah, you will know that, yeah, this is malicious. So why not let the compiler do the injection for this case? Okay, so I'm calling this the compiler hack of table. It's like the holy grail already. Okay, so let's open this. Okay, so this compiler hack ultimate, same thing, it still can hack the login program. It will hack the SHA-256 program. And now you hack itself. But the problem is when you hack itself, right, you need to inject 3 sets of code inside here. You need to inject the login malicious code, the malicious code for SHA-256, and the malicious code of itself, you know. So here, you see how long the code is now already. Okay, let's run it. Okay, so we can actually discard the source code, technically. Compiler hack ultimate, SHA-256.c-evil. Okay, so just now we tried to compile the clean one, right? But notice here, it's injected the malicious code in to the SHA-256. Okay. 7C76. Okay, so we verify that the malicious injection of SHA-256 is working. So for verification sake, let's see what does the Apple's clean one say. So hack ultimate dots. Okay, this is what actually should exist. It returns the SHA-sum of the clean one. So okay, now what I'll do is that I'll use this holy grail compiler to compile the original clean source code. Because you may suspect that your own compiler is bad, right? Let's compile itself. So let me call this ultimate child compiler. Okay, so even though the compiler source code is supposedly clean, but you can see, right, it's injected the entire malicious code in. Start here. Yeah, it's too long to show here. Ultimate char compiler. Compiler.c. Anyway, sorry. Should we move on to the next thing? So even the child compiler, when you compile the SHA-256 program, right, you will still do the injection. Now let's test this again against the ultimate child compiler. It still returns 7076. No matter what compiler binary you throw at it, right, you still give the value that you expect it to be. So now you can see, let me compile again one more time. I can call this ultimate child compiler to. Yeah, everything still works. All the injector code is still inside. Okay, so now let's come to the Thompson's conclusion. You can't trust code that you not actually totally create yourself. So no amount of source level verification or scrutiny will protect you from untrusted code. So for my examples you have seen, right? So no, even if you inspect all the source code looks clean. But as long as your compiler is the one that is bad, right? You cannot trust whatever output is given to you. And we can actually go lower to avoid detection. So the example I've shown you is SHA-256. But we can actually go to like assembler, loader, or microcode if you get the time. So the final conclusion, you always have to trust somebody. Yeah. Okay. So this is where his paper ends and another paper begins. So actually this paper here is a 2009 PhD dissertation by this guy called David A. Wheeler. So he actually tries to find, is there a way to counter this? So his paper is entitled Fully Countering Trusting Trust Through Diverse Double Compiling. So what is this? So the objective is to detect the trusting trust attack. So here's the requirement. You need to use another compiler, or at least two compilers, one of which under test, and the source code of the compiler under test needs to be available. So this is a GCC process. So now we have a GCC and TCC compiler. We suspect that GCC is a bad one. Okay, so let's classify GCC as the compiler under test and the independent compiler as TCC. So here the requirements for independent compiler, you just have to be small. You just enough code to compile the compiler under test. So TCC doesn't have to be very big. It just has to be capable enough to compile GCC. Okay, so what's the process here? So here, let's start with the left. So here is the GCC. You pass in the source code of GCC. Technically, it should generate another version of GCC. So after that, you send in another source code of GCC to itself, and you compile another binary. So here is a self-regeneration test, it's control. So these two here, the binaries, must be equivalent, logically. Okay, so now let's go on to here. So TCC, right, we pass the source code of GCC to TCC, you compile a version of GCC. Then we pass the source code of GCC to this. So you generate another compiler binary. So both should be identical. If both is identical, that means you can be reasonably confident that there's no problem in GCC. So why? So you can see here, GCC can be malicious, but it's unlikely to be malicious in a way that affects GCC. So the assumption here is that when a compiler hacker, right, wants to hack the compiler, you only look for a version of itself. It will not look for another version. Like if you infect GCC, right, it's unlikely that it will infect GCC, and vice versa. And another thing here is that it's easier to reveal a smaller verifying compiler source code. GCC can be very small. Maybe just, okay, I'm not sure how many lines of code, but definitely smaller than GCC. So it's easier to check. So if you are worried that hacker, right, say, okay, hacker must compromise both GCC and TCC in the same way. If hacker were to program TCC to recognize GCC, and you inject the source code to GCC, you can always bring in another compiler, for example, Intel compiler, and just repeat the process, all should be identical. Okay, so the hacker must compromise GCC, TCC, and Intel to be successful. So this is actually a O(n) squared problem for hackers. So in most security issues, right, the hacker usually has an easier time. You just need to find a weak point and exploit it, and the defender has to secure everything. But in this case, right, the hacker has to infect all the compilers and to make sure each compiler infects every other compiler. So this is O(n) squared problem. And for defender, it's O(n) problem because you just need to secure all the compilers. Okay, so now we move on to the next paper, which is actually a critic of GCC. So this guy here is a PhD student from University of Glasgow. So he's basically trying to critique the second paper. So let's look at his critique. So the first critique is that you must trust the independent compiler, which in this case is TCC. So his issue here is that if you're going to go through all these measures, right, might as well you just use TCC to compile GCC and forget about test altogether, right? So you still have to trust the independent compiler. Thompson is still right. Then another thing is that multiple GCC is infeasible. Okay, so in theory, right, you can get GCC, TCC, Intel, and maybe Clang, you add into the mix to compile each other. But the problem is, right, in reality, compiler bugs and source code is not easily compilable by each other. Each version of compiler, right, by the different vendors, right, they support a different subset of C or C++ or whatever language for that matter. So you need to do some adjustment to make sure that this compiler source code can be compiled by another compiler. Okay. Another thing is that it's very time consuming to do this. So GCC takes 2 hours to even compile itself on a reasonably fast machine. Imagine if you're going to do all these things, right, how long that would take already. And another thing here, ON versus ON square. So we talked about that. But the thing is, in practice, N is very small because there's not many C compilers in existence. So the argument that made by him is that if you have a lot of money, like for example an organization or nation, right, you can actually do this. Just infect all the limited number of compilers. I don't think there are like 10 or 20 at the most. Yeah. So attacks not restricted to compiler level. So Wheeler assumes attacks occur during compile time, but external virus can also do that. You don't need to rely go through a compiler, and you can affect both. Okay, so his conclusion, DDC is not foolproof, but it's still useful to flag discrepancies for further examination. Okay, so yeah, the end. Okay, questions? Yeah.
So how did Wheeler, the guy who said use multiple compilers to like check the other
okay.
one? How the hell does he propose to like check the identical? Because that seems like, how do you check two sort of compilers are identical?
No, check their binaries are identical.
Why wouldn't it?
Here.
Like, so the compiled one.
Yeah, so there are a few steps here. So by right, right, even if let's say there's some differences in the way Intel does things, right? By right, you generate a version of GCC. So if they semantically correct, right, if you pass the source code GCC to a compiled GCC, even though it's compiled by another compiler, it should generate the same binary as everybody else.
Assuming a deterministic build.
Yes, it's a deterministic build. But in practice, yeah, here, so that's why this guy, the Paul Jack Ma, right, he raised this point. It's difficult to actually achieve this deterministic view because you need to adjust the source code to make sure other compilers can compile it. Questions anymore? Yeah.
Sorry, so assuming like all the compiler changes are in source control, couldn't you, assuming all the compiler changes, and your malicious change obviously will not be in
yes.
the compiler's git repository or whatever, right? So why don't you run the bootstrap from the beginning, the first commit of the compiler source?
You still need an independent compiler.
Yeah, I still need another compiler.
But the compiler must have started, say, from assembly code, right? So someone wrote an assembly version of the compiler, which could be audited, right?
Yeah, so you can actually do that, but then there's another argument against that. Somebody must trust you.
Sure. So I can, for my own usage of a compiler, git clone the compiler source.
You can do that, but then the thing is, you can't distribute it to anybody else because if I trust you, who knows where you got that binary from?
Of course.
Yeah. So that's still the main argument of Thompson.
And on a more practical note, it means you have to bootstrap a GCC compiler by hand-coding binary code.
No, initially there must be a compiler built in an assembler, right?
Yeah, to hand-code an assembler, then use
the
assembler.
That must have been already done.
Yeah, but you can't use other people's code because then you will need something to compile it. If you're truly bootstrapping from scratch, you need to bootstrap from constructing the assembler, then assembling the compiler.
Then so you need the operating system to run that compiler, right? So who's to say that operating system is the one that...
Like, what's the rabbit hole? It's like, so if you have assembler, right? So you need something to assemble your assembler. What if somebody compromised your CPU microcode? Do you trust Intel to ship you?
I suspect a bit that it's not particularly practical.
Now, how much effort you want to spend, how much money you want to spend.
So, I mean, why is it? You don't see this effect outside because it's quite difficult to.
Yeah, difficult to pull off this one.
But
on the other hand, it's difficult to pull off and detect.
In theory, there's nothing that prevents you from doing this, right?
Yeah, actually, this is a theoretical possibility. I mean, based on the example I showed, I can write this code all up by myself. So who's good to say that somebody else can do the same in a much more refined way? Yeah, so any more questions?
Actually, you can hand compile, then that might be fine. If the very first compiler is small enough to...
you have to handcraft.
Which is how the first
Lisp compiler
got started, actually.
Right, you have to handcraft your binary code. the traditional way with pencil and paper and key in Exodus.
You don't have to actually bootstrap GCC. You can bootstrap another compiler like TCC. GCC is much simpler.
No, as in the first commit of GCC, actually. I don't mean you start from
If you're going to hand compile, you're going to hand compile your assembler and compiler.
Yeah.
You don't need to start with first commit.
Because, because too big,
presumably you can trust your hand compile code. Just that it'll take a long time.
The input must be simple, right? To do it by hand.
Yeah.
So I need to use the very first version, the GCC 0.00 whatever, right? The simplest...
Actually, I wonder the first version of GCC was compiled by what? Then I didn't find out. How did they start off GCC?
We did an assembly, basically.
Somebody started with binary code and produced an assembler.
This is equivalent for interpreters as well?
Yes, it will technically work also for interpreters because interpreter has to be compiled by something else in the first place.
But interpreters are generally not self-hosted, so it's a little bit different.
Yeah. Can
you can have a self-hosted interpreter.
But that means your interpreter needs a compilation mode, right? Otherwise, you can never get rid of the very first interpreter.
Yeah.
If to be truly self-hosted, you must be able to get rid of your first interpreter. Then your interpreter now becomes a compiled language.
Something to compile your interpreter. Yeah, it's like similar to GCC. Like, if the C didn't exist, the first C was somehow must have been assembly somehow, somewhere. I think the problem is that, like what you say, right, it's actually, Ken Thompson, he mentioned this in paper, I think what he says is that the problem is, in the end, right, you have the, you write your own bootstrapper or whatever, but only you can trust yourself.
Yeah,
no one else will trust you.
Even if we have each of our keys, I can't trust the keys from you, and we have to do crypto signing parties, actually. I have to see you in person, this is your key, okay, this is you. Right? I mean...
Yeah,
so...
Okay. Is there any more?
Sure.
Okay, if no more, then I'll stop the recording.